Hi guys, welcome back to the class of Geomatics Engineering, and this is the third lecture in this series. So let us move ahead and see today's topic. Today we are going to start your module 1.2, okay, and that will be incorporating your linear measurements and compass survey, okay. So linear measurements and compass survey. So there will be two things into this, okay. So first part will be your linear measurements through chain surveying. I will cover up the complete theory into this, okay. First we will see definitions and procedure whatever are there, okay. Then we will go for equipment and then we will go for error. And then second part will comprise of this 1.2, second part will comprise of compass survey, in which again I will cover up almost same thing. Definition and types of compass and procedure, whatever procedure you should follow on field. Then we will go for bearings. There are two types of bearing used, that they, those are WCB, whole circle bearing, and another one is also there, I will tell at the time, okay. Quadrantal bearing is, okay. Quadrant bearing, okay. So, yeah, and then correction, obviously correction. These are the most important corrections. Please do not overlook corrections. Those are the most important topics from which a gate question may come, okay. So corrections, please do not ignore them. Okay. So let us move ahead. And for today, our learning objective will be to cover as much as possible from chain survey. Please let me write over here chain survey. Okay. So we will see how to do linear measurement. We will go through definitions. Then we will go for equipments like chain, tape, and auxiliary, accessories. What are they? Then we will go for errors if the time permit, as it will demand, okay. Yeah, so let us move ahead and see. Let me start with the procedure first, an overview of what chain surveying is all about. I hope you recall the principles. There were two principles of surveying. First one was reconnaissance, okay, reconnaissance, which means hold to part, and the second one was establish any reading by at least two measurements. So if you have got only a chain, how you will define or decide that whether it is correct or not? By two measurements as well as by following a reconnaissance, okay. So obviously there are two types of procedure followed. First one is method of ties and the second one is method of offset, okay. So ties means, suppose this is my main line, main survey line, okay, and I want to locate one point. So I know this distance and this distance. These are two important points marked on main survey line. If I know this L1 and L2, then I can use a chain and make a circle something like this. Correct? Something like this. I can use the chain to make a circle something like this at L1 length. Correct? An arc will be drawn, okay, on the field, and then I will use the same chain to make another arc at L2 of radius L2, okay, from this point. So let us name it, suppose this main line was AB and the secondary point which I needed was CD. So from C I will take the radius of L1, that is chain length of L1, and mark approximate curve so that I can get somewhat distance from your E. Let us name it E. Correct? And then again from the D, I will repeat the same procedure. Wherever these curves intersect, that will be my point E. Correct? So here this CE and your DE are called ties. Okay? These are called ties. Okay? So that is why method of ties. Okay? And what about offset method? Let me choose a different color so that it is perfectly visible. I will use one instrument such as with some crossbar or something such that I can get this point. I will plot first of all this point, okay, so using my map, okay. So A, B, C, D, let me name it P. Is it okay? And then I will draw the perpendicular line from it to this point E. Correct? So this is called method of offset. Offsets are always perpendicular perpendicular to main survey line or something, some line, any subsidiary line also you can use. Okay, so method of offset. So here you can see that E will be called offset. I hope this is very clear now. Okay, yeah, and let us move ahead then. Lengths are measured from a main survey line baseline using chain or tape. Okay, so obviously this line will be called your main survey line or chain. And remember, the accuracy of main survey or baseline. I should have written baseline. I have done completely wrong. Please rewrite it. Main survey line or baseline. Okay. So this main survey line or baseline should be the most accurate one. Correct? This should always be the most accurate one. Okay. Yeah. And obviously these points should be defined and established during the reconnaissance itself. Okay. So these will be the most outermost points of the most importance, of the highest importance. Just for example, if you are going for your own home construction, whenever you are buying the plot, first of all, what you will look at? You will look at all the corners of your plot and make sure that your land has not been occupied by your neighbors. Correct? So you will locate the corner points first and then measure the distance between them first and make sure that whatever length is being quoted by the seller is being bought by you. Is it clear? Okay. Yep. So please remember this part. And the reconnaissance survey is also done to give you a complete overview of the plot or the land to be surveyed. Suppose land is a hilly terrain. You go and see what could be the line exactly, how can I proceed. So during the reconnaissance, you note down territories very meticulously. You plan out everything which is to be done, what should be the method, how you will proceed, what should be your control points, what should be your main baseline, where to focus most for the maximum accuracy. So these all surveys, points are located in your mind during reconnaissance. Okay. Remember, surveying is a great art, and that is, I hope if you recall in my first lecture, I have already told you that even Mr. E. Sridharan, who is revered as one of the greatest railway engineers, who is chief of DMRC, is said to be the master of surveying. He was posted in your Western Ghat region, Western Ghat Railways. So that was his very big credit. From there he has seen that upslope rise. Okay. So chains have nowadays, okay, yeah, I wanted to say that for chain surveying, there are two principal instruments. Those are tape and chains. Correct? But nowadays, chains have become almost obsolete. Almost obsolete because the maintenance of the chains was very high. Okay? So these days, most preferred ones are invert tapes, but still they are costly. So we use them for important works. Whereas steel band is most widely used for ordinary works. Okay? So these tapes are usually very flexible, whereas chain is not that much flexible. Further, on tapes you can mark each and every centimeter in even in terms of mm. So accuracy has also increased. So why to go for chains, which are very heavy, bulky and tough to carry? Okay. So that is why we have switched on to tapes. Okay. Okay. Further, when large areas is to be surveyed, the whole area is divided into well-conditioned triangles. What is well-conditioned triangle? I will tell you the definition, do not worry. But as I was telling you that the reconnaissance survey or preliminary survey, remember, is done so that the whole area can be divided into well-conditioned triangles. Main points could be located. Okay. So, yeah, please make sure that you remember these things. Okay. So let me take you through the procedure how to or chain survey. Okay, so usually these are the steps followed. Correct. First, you will go and do reconnaissance. Okay, so survey the complete area and then divide it how to proceed and whatever is there. Then, after reconnaissance, obviously, you must have made a physical image in your mind. Then, Accordingly, you will mark the stations, important stations, secondary stations, and all those. So you will establish them. Okay. Then running survey lines. Okay. So secondary points will be marked on the basis of your primary stations. So you will run main survey line, baseline, and then take offset, then measure ties or something like that. Exactly. So everything you will do during this. Okay. And the second thing, as I was telling you, that you will be taking offsets. Okay. Usual permissible error. Usual, please remember, I am writing usual permissible error. Rather, you can say a good draught man should not, should be as precise as 0.25 mm on paper. Okay. On paper, in the sense, you have prepared a map, okay, on your paper, piece of paper, A4 size sheet, it may be A5 size or not A5, A5 is very small usually nowadays. A4 means A1 to A4 size paper you have taken and you have plotted a map or plan. So based on that map or plan, you should be able to distinguish at least 0.25 mm until that point. Okay. So this much accuracy you should achieve, and accordingly you should scale up, scale down on the field. Okay. Usually you will scale up only because the scaling factors are less than 1. Okay. Yeah. So, yep. So the next thing is very important. Please pay close attention to this point. Obstacles in chaining. Okay. So obviously whenever you will be chaining, chaining means taking the measurement using chains, taking horizontal distances using chain, or establishing horizontal control using chains. Remember, in surveying we call it control. Taking horizontal measurements means establishing horizontal control. Okay. So obstacle, there may be two types of obstacle. Obviously, first one will be chaining around is possible. Suppose I am going through a terrain and suddenly there came a hill, something like this. So how will I proceed now? There is a single isolated hill, or you can say a big boulder came in between. Correct. So that I cannot use my ranging rod or chain right from here to here. Okay. Even if the ranging rod is visible, still I cannot see, means send my tape all around. Correct. Obviously, this I cannot dig a tunnel and all those things just for this surveying. What I will do, I will simply take a plan. Okay. And I will plot this obstacle. So now my ranging rod, one ranging rod is over here, another ranging rod is over here. What I will do, suppose this is my main line or whatever line of survey, correct? I will establish perpendicular lines to this, okay? So this will be your perpendicular line, and then again over here, parallel to this line and perpendicular to this line. I will establish, and then from here to here, I will measure the distance. So simply the obstacle is bypassed and you simply add this, plus this, plus this, that's all. Okay. So if chaining around is possible, you will proceed in this way. Okay. If chaining around is not possible, suppose river comes in between. So this is my area under consideration, complete area, correct? There is a river. Now how will you proceed, or I will proceed? You can suggest it. Can you suggest it? Yeah. Obviously, what you will use similar triangles property or even congruent triangle property. Any property you can use. Okay. So here you will establish a control line. Suppose this was my point. Okay. I have to find out distance between two points. Correct. So this is my line. I wanted to take it this way. Correct. But here the river is there. How can I proceed? What I will do, I will establish a I will put one ranging rod over here, one ranging rod over here, and then extend this line to this point. Correct? Then I will extend this line such that this makes perpendicular line. I have already taken this as perpendicular. So now, I hope you are clearly seeing that these two triangles, this A, B, O, let me name it O, then C, and then D. So triangle A, B, O is similar to triangle C, O, sorry, yeah, D, C, O. Are they symmetric? Yep, correct. So obviously, if you want to find out distance between CD, so how much will be CD? CD upon OC is equal to, you have to find out CD. CD is unknown, but you have, can find out OC. Obviously, you can find out, correct? And then this will be equal to your AB. AB calculation you have already done, divided by your AB, correct? So you can simply use similar triangles property and find out anything you want. Suppose you want the distance between A and D, then obviously even then you can find out, even that you can find out, okay? You can find out the distance between AO directly, and OD you can use similar triangle property, okay? So I hope this is clear to you, okay? So let us move ahead and see what is next. Yeah, definitely basic definitions, okay? So you can see over here, so I have written here A, B, C, D are main stations. So let me draw the figure as well, okay? With that, I will keep on telling you what are these definition means, okay? So let us take a plot area, something like this, a very big plot area. Suppose maybe a mall may be coming or something like that, very big area, okay? So I have to survey this, correct? I have to mark few important points and all those. Even you can take the road alignment, something like that, okay? Yeah. So obviously in this plot, when I will go first, what I will do? I will mark the important points, correct? So main stations I will mark, and they will be A, B, A, B, then C, sorry, C, and then here D, correct? So these four are the main stations, correct? Tie station on or on subsidiary station, okay? Or this is or, not on, okay? Yeah. So main station is a point in chain survey where two sides of a triangle meet, okay? So now I have to go for triangulation. Please remember, so the best way to triangulate it will be which one? Remember, I can always draw a line joining AC, okay? Any diagonal is better, no issue. I have overlapped it. So let me erase one part, okay? So okay, AD. AD is your AC, sorry, AC is your, let us say, main baseline, okay? So AC is main survey line, okay? And apart from AC, what else will be main survey line? Your AD, CD, AB, and BC, okay? So that means all the four sides of the rectangle which help in defining the complete area will be the main survey line, okay? So in this figure, we can take that there will be five main survey lines, okay? Okay, then comes tie line or subsidiary line. Okay, no. After main survey line, let us jump to tie station or subsidiary station. Tie station is a station on the survey line, on a survey line joining two main stations. These are helpful in locating the interior detail of the area to be surveyed, okay? So let me choose a different color so that I can mark it for you. So suppose I want to locate few important points. Suppose there is some tree or something like that. So for that reason, I will mark few points which are distinguishable, identifiable on the site, okay, for easy marking. So suppose any point on this will be called your subsidiary or tie station, okay. So this will be, violet color is for tie station. So let us name it in small letters if you wish, okay? So let me name it A, B, C, D, then comes your E, and then, is it clear? Then comes your tie line or subsidiary line. The chain line joining two tie stations is called tie line. Please remember, this is two, okay? Numerical two, not two, okay? Chain line joining two tie stations is called tie line. So obviously this line will be your tie, okay? So one purpose of them is to establish the control points, controlling points, okay? So you can join it. Is it clear? So these all A, B, AD, BD, AC, these all will be called tile lines. Okay. So is it clear? Yeah. So these are also called auxiliary lines. Tile lines are provided to locate interior details which are far away from the main line. So suppose I want to locate a tree, separate tree, somewhere over, I will show a little less bright color. Somewhere over here. Correct? So, what I can do? I can use this tie line to find out an offset distance for this tree. Correct? And vice versa. Okay? I can use this tie line to measure the distance of tree from this tie line and plot it on my paper. Okay? So, accordingly, I can proceed ahead. Okay? So, remember, the tie lines are provided to locate interior details. Okay, so interior details means like maybe tree, maybe some hill, so maybe whatever is there. Okay, so you use them to provide that. Okay. Next one is baseline. This is the longest main survey line on a fairly level ground and passing through the center of the area. It is most important line. Remember, most important line. As directions of all other survey lines are fixed with respect to this one. So, which line in the above figure seems as a baseline? Obviously, it is AC. So, the whole accuracy depends on which, whom, that is AC will be your baseline. Okay. So, every accuracy depends on AC. Hence, the AC should be plotted with as much accuracy as possible. Okay, yeah. The next one is your check line. Check line or the proof line is the line provided to check the accuracy of the fieldwork. Please remember, this is provided to check the accuracy of fieldwork. So, how you can provide it and where to find it? Let me again take some different color so that I wanted to use black, but okay, it is not available. Since it is not available, let me use blue. So what I will do, I will draw an offset line from here to here, okay, and then measure this distance. Let me name it A, B, C, D, then P, correct, and from here also I will draw the offset line, okay, and let me name it Q. So this is perpendicular, this is perpendicular, okay. So I will measure the distance DP and BQ, okay, and find the same distance using my map. So, the congruency between the values will define that this much accurate is my map. So, this is the accuracy of my map. Okay. It should be especially regarding your main stations and baseline. The accuracy tolerance should be minimum. Minimum is approximately equal to zero. It should almost match it. Okay. And even it should match till the 0.25 mm on paper. Okay. So 0.25 mm on paper. Okay. So a good draftsman has that much efficiency. Okay. Yeah. Then comes your offset. Offset, I think I have already told you. It is a distance of the object from the survey line. It may be perpendicular or oblique. Okay. Yeah. I have told you, I think that it is perpendicular. But remember, in some cases, you can also take the oblique one. There is a special instrument which is used to establish such controls. I will show you. Do not worry about that. Okay. Then comes your chainage. Chainage is the distance measured along the main survey line in the direction of progress of work. The term chainage is used in linear construction of construction projects such as roads, railways, and sewers to distinguish a unique point on the work. Okay. So obviously, whenever you will see the road, what they will write? They will write 200 meter. Something like that. Whenever you will see the project, 0 meter. Something like that they will always write. Keep writing. So that they have a specific reference point from a given point. So after every point, they will put a milestone at the corner. And they, if they refer, suppose there is some problem. Some problem due to any reason. So they can refer it easily. Go to 445 meters and there is a big boulder or there is a cavity inside, which is destabilizing your road. So something like that they can refer very uniquely. Okay. Yeah, now the most important definition, please remember in the your surveying. Okay, well-conditioned triangles. Okay, so if you can establish well-conditioned triangles, your half work is already done. Okay, half work, not complete. Okay, yeah. So well-conditioned triangles in chain survey, attempts should be made to select main survey station such that they form well-conditioned triangles. So a triangle is said to be well-conditioned if all the intersections of line are clear for plotting purposes. Okay, so it says that suppose, as I was telling you, I have to draw two ties, correct? Use two ties. So what I will do, I will take a length L1 and draw intersect like this. Okay, and then from here again I will take something like this and intersect. So you can see that these two are intersecting very perfectly, clearly. Okay, so it says that the clear intersections are achieved when the angles between lines are between 30 degree to 120 degree. Please remember these values, these are numerical values. The angles should be this angle, this theta should be between 30 degree to 120 degree. Correct? So that is the condition for triangulation. Okay? So yeah, clear intersections should be achieved. That is the main objective. And how to achieve it? 30 degree to 120 degree should be the angle. Okay? Yeah. Now let us move ahead and see what are the equipments which are used in chain surveying. Okay? So first equipment is the name itself, that is chain. Chains are used in chain surveying. Okay, so let us start. Let me first put my face somewhere over here so that you can see it very clearly. Yeah, this is a typical diagram of the chain. I don't think that you need to go through that much meticulously for gate purpose. Okay, you can still see that there is a small groove. This is handle. Then here comes collar. Then I volt, and then links are there in the chain. I hope you know the difference between chain and tape. So this is chain. Tape are usual measuring tape at you use at your home. Okay, your mother might be having for sieving purposes. You yourself might have done used it in the civil engineering laboratory or any lab you might have visited. Okay, so the normal tape is itself a tape. Okay, it is usually made up of mixed cloth reinforced with some kind of metal as per the requirements. Okay, as per the requirements, in the sense, it may be reinforced with brass and copper, it may be reinforced with steel, it may be reinforced with invar metal and all those. Okay, so that is flexible, completely flexible. This is rigid. Okay, so this, when folded, it folds something like this, so it will be a complete bundle like thing. Okay, so here there will be a handle. Okay, here again there will be a handle. So this is tied up and taken to the field. So these are very bulky, and for ease of taking observations, at every 10 meter there is one brass tag. So those tag also vary. So at 10 meter the tag will be 10 meter or 90 meter. Usually the length is 100 meter which is used. So obviously your this metric chain is used mostly in present scenario or engineer's chain. Okay, so anyways, after every 10 meter you will put a tag of this kind. Okay, this kind. So this can also be provided at 1 meter. Please remember 1 meter. Okay, this bifurcated, so two spikes are there, correct? I should delete it so that you do not get confused. I'm really sorry. Erase it. So you can see that one point is there. Okay, then yeah, so there is only one point, hence that represents 10 or 1, or in other way 100 minus. Okay, then comes your 2 points, that means 20 or 80. Then comes 3. So either a triangle will be made, or usually, which is more common, is your 3-pointed circular hook. Okay, tag means. Then comes your 4. And if it is complete circle, then obviously it represents 50. Okay, 50 meters, obviously, or 50 think. Okay, yeah. So you can see over here, please remember there are 4 types of chain in use. It is very improbable that gate may ask, but still I will say that please keep this thing in mind so that even if it asks, you do not miss it, because there may be a question related to match the following. Okay, So it has been a practice in the gate that sometimes gate does unexpected things. So due to that, I am teaching it. Otherwise, do not pay very much huge attention onto this. Okay. So there are four types of chain: revenue chain, which has total length of 33 feet and number of links is 60. Please remember this thing. Match the following kind of questions can be made on this thing. Okay. Guntur chain, 66 feet and 100 links. Then comes your engineering chain, 100 feet and 100 links. Okay. 1 feet is the length of each link, a distance between each link. Okay. Then comes your metric chain. These come in two lengths. This chain comes in two lengths. First one is 30 meter. The second one is 20 meter. 30 meter will have 150 links and 20 meter will have your 100 links. So effectively one link is of how much? Tell me. So it will be 20 meter divided by 100. That is 1 by 5 meter. That is equivalent to your 200 nano. Am I correct? Yeah. So one link's length is in metric chain is 200 nano. That is very important. Please pay for attention. Okay. You should know what is the length of one link in these chains, all the chains. Okay. Yeah. So let us move ahead now. And now surveying chains, some pros and cons, let us see. Yeah. So obviously pros will be, can be read easily because there are links, number of links, simply count them. And also tags are there, simply see the tag and you will get. Okay. Then they are suitable for rough use. Obviously they are made up of, completely made up of steel or iron. So although they are heavy, but still they, you can drag them through the forest, through the grasslands, through anywhere. And they won't get easily damaged. Okay. And even if they are damaged, you can very easily repair them. Only thing is, they are linked by links. So you can simply open up or plug them back using plas and all those, whatever tools are there. Okay, general tools. They can be very easily repaired. Okay. Cons. Heavier, hence shack correction becomes very prominent. Please remember, in surveying chains, the shack correction is very prominent because they are very heavy. So whatever amount of pull you apply, there will be sag. Definitely there will be some sag. Suitable for ordinary work. Very precise work cannot be done because, as I have already told you, one link's distance is 200 mm. So least count also becomes 200 mm. Okay. So if you want to go finer than 200 mm, then it is very difficult. Okay. Then again, IS code means prescriptions. Okay. So please remember this. Two, three lines. These are very, very important. Mark them somewhere in your copy. Okay. As for IS codes, the permissible error in every 1 meter under standard tension of 80 Newton is equal to plus minus 2 mm. Okay. So in any chain for 1 meter, you have to take out 1 meter span and the error should not be more than plus minus 2 mm at 80 Newton pull. Please remember at 80 Newton pull. So there are three things: every 1 meter, 80 Newton and plus minus 2 mm. Please note it down. Okay. Then comes your 20 meter chain's total length. So total error should be plus minus 5 mm. Means that is tolerable, plus minus 5 mm. Then comes 30 meter chain's length, that is plus minus 8 mm. Okay. So please note down these values. These are very, very important from the examination point of view. Okay. Because these have been prescribed by IS codes. Okay. Different IS codes have been referred and from there it has been taken. These values have been taken. So this is highly probable question. Okay. Yeah. Now come to tapes. Obviously your tapes are again of four types. First one is cloth or linen type, second one is metallic tape, third one is steel tape and fourth one is invar tape. Invar tape is the very costly and most precise out of all the three. Okay. So cloth or linen type was the most primitive one to replace your chains. Okay. But the problem with it was that it shrinks after it absorbs the moisture. Okay. And also it is not reinforced, hence it very easily twisted in strong winds. Okay. It is very lightweight. So not that much ragged. Very easily decays. Okay. Then we switched on towards metallic tapes. So as I was telling you, that steel bands are very much popular nowadays. You too might have seen at your home or somewhere. Okay, you yourself might have used it. Okay, so obviously in this linen tape with brass or copper wires interwoven, highly accurate and used to measure offset. Okay, so metallic tape is widely used to measure offset. Okay, for ordinary works. Remember, for ordinary works. Okay, yeah. Then comes your steel tape, which is more accurate than metallic tape. This is actually more used than as compared to metallic tapes. Cannot be used in grounds with vegetation, obviously, because you have to rectify, because they are flexible, so there will be bumps. And also steel is prone to corrosion, so vegetation will have moisture which will try to corrode your steel tape. Although that won't happen in one day, that will take time. Okay, but still it is not preferred. The best one till now is Invar tape. So what is Invar? It is the alloy of nickel 36%. So nickel 36 Ni 36% plus steel 64%. Correct? These tapes have very low coefficient of thermal expansion. So the best thing about it is it has the least amount of thermal expansion, that is alpha is equal to 0.122 multiplied by 10 to the power minus 6 per degree Celsius. Please remember, this is very, very less, and hence it is the best tape to be used. Okay, it is available in the length of 30 meter, 50 meter, 100 meter, and width of 6 mm. So it is very thin as well, not even, it's just this much. Okay, so not even one part of your finger. Okay, so 0.6 mm is very less. Okay, advantage: highly precise, less affected by temperature. Disadvantage: soft. This is the disadvantage of almost all the tapes. Okay, soft, hence deforms easily, requires much attention in handling, and hence used only for important works. Okay, so you can still use steel tape, it will be better, but still it is like that. Okay, now comes accessories. So accessories are required. So whenever you are doing surveying, there is one master and another one is follower. Okay, so one who leads is usually master, and then follower follows him. Okay, so yeah, sorry, follower goes ahead and master follows, actually. Okay, so obviously there will be requirement of some means marking devices, marking tools and all those. So for that there are pegs and arrows. Okay, so there are two types of means marking devices. First one is pegs and another one is arrow. Correct? So obviously pegs, it may be wooden or steel, and they are used to create temporary or semi-permanent definite points. Okay, so the best way is to insert them perpendicularly. Please remember, they should be inserted perpendicularly, not slanting. Correct? Arrow are more dynamically used. These are used to create temporary stations or semi-permanent stations. But when you will use arrow, with every movement of chain, okay, so your follower will keep pegging and master will keep collecting them. So it acts as additional check. It acts as additional check on the final number of chain edge. Suppose the master has collected 10 number of pegs, 10 number of arrows, sorry, 10 number of arrows. That means that 10 times the chain has been used. Okay, so 10 times multiplied by the chain length. Okay, so like that you can proceed ahead. Yeah, and for your arrow, this figure you can refer. Okay, so the die is 50 mm, it is circular at the top so that it can be inserted very easily, very sharp pointed at the base so that it can go inside, and it is of 4 mm dia. That's black wire. Yeah, these are ranging rods. Please have a close look. Okay, so these are marked with alternate red and white bands. Okay, so both have approximately 200 mm length. Okay, so yeah, and this is your offset rod. Let us move ahead. And so this is your offset rod. Okay, yeah, so there is one narrow slit into this, one narrow slit, if this is in this direction, then another narrow slit will be in this direction as well, so that you can check the perpendicularity of any line. Okay. Yeah. So these are used to establish offsets. Okay. And there is slight hook like thing at the top. Okay. And usually the pegs are used with the flags. Not pegs actually. These are ranging rods. Ranging rods are used with flags. Usually, not always. Okay. So, and also plumb bob is used to ensure the verticality of ranging rods. Okay. So the process of locating a number of points on a long survey line is called ranging or ranging out. Please note down the definition of ranging or ranging out. That is, process of locating a number of points on a long survey line is called ranging or ranging out. Okay. So ranging rods are used to locate intermediate points such that these points lie on a straight lines joining the ends of the line. Okay. So obviously if they are placed something like, suppose I am placing my rod first over here, then the second point over is somewhere very far away. Okay. So what I will say, I will ask someone from my followers or my co-workers to stand with a peg in between, keeping it completely vertical, and I will see through that all the three stand in a line. Okay, all the three rods stand in a single line of sight. Okay, so once that is done, I will say that my line is straight and now I can measure my one chain length from here to here and then another chain length from here to here. Is it clear? Since this is line is very big as compared to one chain length. Okay, yeah. So ranging rods are used to locate intermediate points such that these points lie on straight line joining ends stations. Ranging must be used is must before starting measurement of a line whose length is more than chain length such that the measurement is made along a straight line. Okay. Obviously, I have already told you they are 30 mm in diameter, 2 to 3 meter long. Yeah. In absence of chain, sometimes you can also use ranging rods as your approximate distance measuring tool. Okay. So their length is usually fixed, either it will be 2 or 3. Okay. So that you have to start. And one thing, their markings, that is their mark alternate red or black or and white. So one will be either red or black and another will be white. Okay. And width of this, sorry, length of this band is 200 mm. Okay. 200 mm. Please remember. Then comes your offset rod. Same properties are there except two things. First thing is perpendicular slit is there in the offset rod. And the second thing is on the top there is hook. Okay. So nothing different. Just offset rods are used to create the offset. To starting at the starting point of offset. Okay. So I hope this is clear. Let us move ahead and see other equipments which are used to establish right angles. Okay. So obviously this is crosstalk. So, crosstalk, adjustable crosstalk, optical square and prism square. So, obviously this is based on prism and the reflection is the major criteria over there. Okay. So, two mirrors are placed at 45 degree and they are used to reflect, get the image of your 90 degree object which overlaps with your present condition, okay, present ranging rod. Okay. Yeah. So that is good thing. And the second thing is adjustable crosstalk. Adjustable crosstalk. These are actually crosstalk. So one line you will align along the your main survey line. And then you use your perpendicular line to fix up the ranging rods. Okay. So first you will see, put them on. Suppose, let me draw it. Suppose it is like this. Correct. So what you will do, you will put this thing along your main survey line and then you will see through this one and ask your follower to take a ranging rod and place it somewhere over here so that you can establish this line somewhere like this. Okay. Same applies to these. This is, I think, hexagonal crosstalk. And in this, more options are available. Octagonal means this crosstalk. So here you can also establish your 90 degree, 45 degree, 30 degree. Accordingly, that thing varies. Okay. So there are more number of angles which are available into this. Then comes your adjustable prop stop. So there are functions to adjust. Okay. So you just remember, have in your mind the names of the things so that in case anything is asked, you are ready to answer. Okay. Then comes your ranging or ranging out. There are three parts. First one is direct ranging. You can simply establish your crosstalks at visible distances. So one crosstalk over here, this much, this much, this much, this much, like this. Okay. And simply measure the distance between them using chain lines. Okay. So whatever will be the way. Okay. So this is called direct ranging. Now what starts happening, sometimes you have to switch to indirect ranging, because there is, as I was already telling, there is one boulder. So you cannot take your tape from here to here through this. Or even this is very difficult. Okay. Due to some reasons, that is very difficult. Okay. So what you will do, you will use alternate methods. So suppose this is your obstacle. So what you will do, you will obviously draw perpendicular to this and find out a point over here, draw perpendicular to this. Find out some point over here, then perpendicular to this line you will draw another line so that it intersects over here, and find out the perpendicular distance from this. Okay. Another way to do indirect ranging is repeated alignment. Okay. So this is more of a chainage problem. So obstacles to chainage. This will come in obstacles to chain edge, okay? Because chain cannot go, even if ranging rod can, but chain cannot go. Suppose now a mountain has come somewhere and you cannot see from here the here ranging rod, correct? So what you will do, you will use the alternate method. You will establish two random points, something like this, okay? So if I show you it in the, from the top view, how will it look like? There, if you, this is contour, you can say contour line. Contour line means places of equal elevation, correct? So this is my, okay. So this is almost like plain area, okay? So my, this ranging rod is over here. Another ranging rod, I cannot see this point, correct? So what I will do, I will put my two staffs somewhere over, I will put my staff somewhere over here, correct? So now, and third somewhere over here. Correct? In a line. This whole thing will be in a line. Correct? Now using this point, I can see this. So I will ask this fellow to come in line with this. Okay? So this fellow will move towards this point. Is it clear? Now he can still see this point. Correct? So now he will ask this fella that move to this place. And the same way, the process will continue, and finally you will see that everyone is perfectly aligned. Okay. So all the poles are now perfectly aligned for this point. Okay. So this is called indirect ranging through repeated alignment. Then comes your random line ranging. This is very, very important. Suppose due to some reason you cannot assess this line itself. Okay. So what you can do, you can simply take a random line, draw a random line, you know, and then using your offset method, from here you can draw a perpendicular line. Okay, so you can draw a perpendicular line. Okay, so now what you can do, you can draw the offsets from any point of importance to this line and use the property of similar triangles to find out any distance. Am I clear? Similar triangles. Okay, and also this is suppose AB, which was my major point, and this point is B dash, correct? So you know the BB dash and AB dash. So your AB will be equal to under root, using Pythagoras theorem, AB dash square plus your BB dash square. Okay. So this is the distance between AB, okay, without going for direct range. Okay. So this is called random line ranging, and this is very widely used process and very good process. Okay. So control points length also you can find out by using your which method? Obviously, similar triangles property. Okay. Then comes linear measurement with chain. There can be two types of measurement. First one will be smooth ground, no issues. Simply put your chain, pull it to the required tension, and then measure the length, number of. Okay. So on a smooth ground, there is no issue. But on, when you are going around for sloping knob. Suppose something like this is there. Correct. So here what you will do, you will go for stepping. What is stepping? You will place your ranging rods 5 to 10 meter distance away. 5 to 10 meters distance away as per the requirement. Okay. And use the horizontal chain. Okay. To find out the distance. Then again you will move ahead and again you will find out the horizontal distance. Again move ahead, again horizontal distance. Correct. So in this way you will proceed slowly, slowly to get your spinal chain edge, whatever is there. Okay. 5 to 10 meters spacing, you will find it like this. Ladder like structure will become. Okay. So again, like this. Okay. So like this you will go, and that is called stepping because you are putting, establishing 90 degree angles. Okay. And remember, the uphill is more tough. Doing this survey uphill is tough. And this is little bit easier as compared to this uphill. Okay. Then comes measuring along the slope. So suppose here it is a very abrupt slope, but there is gentler slope. What we can do, we can simply measure the theta. You can simply measure the distance. Suppose let us put it L, and this horizontal distance you have to find out, that is your D. So obviously D is equal to L cos theta. So obviously you can measure along the slope itself and later on put the correction. Okay. So next one is corrections. This is very, very important topic. Please pay close attention. There are seven corrections which have been listed for your chain survey and your tape survey. Okay. So yeah, one thumb rule or one sign convention, please note it down. This is very important. If distance measured is lesser than actual, then correction is positive. If the distance measured is lesser than actual, then your correction is positive. So suppose some distance is 10 meter and report, so 11 meter, suppose some distance is 11 meter and I report it as 10 meter itself. So that correction will be positive. This means correction is equal to positive. And when it will occur? It will occur when I am using faulty tape which is already elongated. So for that tape, 11 meter is being measured as 10 meter. Okay. So it will occur when the tape gets elongated. Okay. And opposite of that is also true. That is, if the distance measured is more than actual, then correction is negative. Okay. So please remember these two thumb rules. These are very, very important and will help you everywhere. Okay. This will happen when the tape is short. Okay. Sorry. Let us go through the name of all the seven corrections once, and then we will move towards individual correction factors. Okay. Here comes correction for standardization. That is, this extra long or extra less, you have to do this correction in the lab. Okay. The next one is correction for slope. Obviously, I have already shown you one simple correction, hypotenuse. Okay. So you are measuring hypotenuse, whereas you want the horizontal distance. Okay. So you can simply apply the cos theta and blah blah whatever is there. Okay. Then comes your correction for pull. Correction for pull means if you overstretch your chain or your tape, what will happen? The chain will get elongated. So obviously there will be a positive error. If due to some other reason your chain has contracted, then there will be some negative error. So usually it is positive error. Usually it is positive error. Please remember, usually, not always. Okay. If the pull is lesser, if pull is high, and if pull is less, even then there will be one error, that will be negative error. Okay. Then comes your correction for temperature. You know that higher temperature means longer length. So higher temperature means positive correction. Sorry, not error. Please remember, error is will have different sign. So let me write correction. Please note, amend it. That is correction. Okay. So for temperature, positive correction. If temperature is high, T field is greater than T standard. Okay. So I am not writing negative one because you should know that negative correction is also there. Let me write it itself. If opposite of this occurs. Okay. Then comes correction for sag. Obviously, whatever be the your effort, there will be always some sag. Some sag will be there, and you should amend that in your means final ones. Okay. So it also can be positive and negative. Then comes correction for misalignment. Sometimes, as I was telling, this is much more prominent in tapes. Okay. So since tapes are very lightweight and they get twisted very easily, they are not that much helpful in vegetation. Hence, what may happen that suppose your tape may go something like this due to some plant. Okay. So such correction factors should be taken care of by using trigonometry, simple trigonometry. Okay. Then comes correction for mean sea level. Okay. So why this correction? This is the most unique correction and very rarely people read it. Why correction for mean sea level? Obviously, have you seen a globe which is rough? Then how can you say that a globe has this much distance and accordingly that much distance? Okay. So how to bring everything to a single standard? What happens? Suppose this is my earth. Correct? So if my Mount Everest height is higher or my reduced level is higher, then obviously I will be measuring a longer distance as compared to when same points will have a distance at MSL. So hence, in few cases, you have to reduce the length to the mean sea level. Okay. So obviously this is your, which one? You are measuring higher distance and while the actual distance is lesser. So this will be your negative if it is higher and vice versa. Okay. Do not worry. Do not need to write. We will cover up individual ones. Okay. So there it will be even more clearer. So let us go to the first correction. And with this first correction, I will end my lecture. That is correction for standardization. As I have already told you that this should be done in the lab. And please remember that IS code, that what are the tolerable limits. Okay. So for 20 mm, it was plus minus 5 mm. Sorry, for 20 meter tape, it was plus minus 5 mm. For 30 meter, it was plus minus 8 mm. And for every meter, 1 meter, there should be at 80 Newton pull. There, the error permissible is not more than plus minus 2 mm. Okay. So this is the standard according to IS code. Okay. So with that, you should standardize your tape first in the lab itself. Okay. So what you do, you have a reference tape and you try to compare it with your present tape. Okay. Reference tape is obviously more accurate. Okay. So it may be in bar tape or something like that, or newly bought tape. That also will work. Okay. And you will maintain the temperature and everything at a fixed level. At a fixed level. Okay. So correction for standardization is equal, is given by, correct length is given by L dash multiplied by L upon L dash, where L dash is measured distance using quality tape. And L dash is nominal length marked on the quality tape and true length on the quality tape. So suppose I have measured 80 meter using a 20 meter tape, whose actual length was 20.5 meter. Okay. So whose actual length was 20.5 meter. So what will be my correct length, which should be on the field? So correct length, which I measured, will be equal to your 80 multiplied by your L means your true length of quality tape. So that is 20.5 divided by 20. Okay. So this is how much? Tell me quickly. Solve it. So corrected length is 82.5 meters. No, sorry. 82 meters. I'm really sorry. This is 82 meters. I have just calculated it. Okay. So 82 meters. So obviously, what is your correction? Please remember correction. I have already told you that correction is negative of error. So correction is equal to correct length minus measured length. Okay. So obviously, what is your correct length? That is 82 meters minus 80 meters. Correction will be 2 meter. Is it clear? And this is positive. Positive means your C over here. Distance measured is lesser than actual, then the correction is positive. Okay. And this will occur only when the tape gets elongated as it was in our case. Okay. So please pay close attention to the things. And one more thing, yeah, to directly find out this formula, you can use CA is equal to this correction, let us name it CA, that is equal to L minus L dash divided by L dash, sorry, L dash multiplied by L dash. So how much will you get? You will get L dash, L minus L dash. L minus L dash means 20.5 minus 20 divided by 20 multiplied by how much? Your 80. Now try to solve this, you should get 2 meters. Okay. So obviously you will get 2 meters and hence your correction for this standardization is 2 meters in this case. Okay. Yeah. So with this I end my lecture. In the next lecture we will see further 6 corrections and we will go for corrections and then we will go for compass survey and in the next, after next lecture I will go for remaining portion of compass survey. And previous year gate questions. Okay. So I will take joint way, in joint way. Okay. So previous year gate questions. So this will be in next lecture and next to next lecture. Okay. So with that I end my lecture. Thank you for watching and keep revising. Okay. Bye bye.